I have the honor to come after Svi, so it will be, I'm sorry, a bit less flashy and a bit boring, but let's go for it. I'm going to talk not about dyes, but about something else, which can be a new opportunity also for textile research. It's about macroxo-fluorescent scanning, the application of it for textiles, and the case study I'm going to talk about is especially the investigation of metal threads in relic purses. In fact, it's a collection of 7 relic purses that belong to the Provincial Museum of Ancient Art in Namur in Belgium. They have been collected in the third quarter of the 19th century from different abbeys and churches, and they now belong to the Archaeological Society in Namur. They have only been published in a small catalog so far from the museum in 2007. And 2 years ago, they started a large interdisciplinary research and conservation project to study them in depth and to safeguard them for the future. These are very fragile reliquary treasures, which have almost not been touched before. And so now, we saw immediately that their preservation state would be a major obstacle for sample taking. We started to do radiocarbon dating and material analysis using different techniques. So for instance, we also analyzed the dyes with HPLC, and we started to identify the metal threads with SEM EDX. Then we took digital and images, and we did optical microscopy and digital microscopy to identify the fibers and the morphology of the metals and so. But then we also tried macro XRF scanning, so I'm going to focus then on the last technique. So macro XRF scanning, before I start with the purses, it's a quite recent development, which makes it possible to do element analysis, for instance, for the investigation of the metal composition in a non-destructive way by scanning a complete area of the object or the object as a whole. And so you get the visualization of the elements present in the object. I'm going to discuss one purse a bit more in detail and then two others very briefly. So this is one of the most important ones. It's a small purse of 12 to 12 centimeters square, with made of silk and metal thread decorations. It has heraldic motifs and stylistic animal motifs. And the repetitive decorative pattern refers to a Spanish origin, according to the information which was mentioned in the catalog at that time. And it's also clearly showing Islamic influences which support that. At the time, it was art historically dated to the 14th century. When we look at the fabric, the weaving is very deteriorated, with many holes, many missing threads. There was a lining originally, which is completely gone, apart from some small thread ends. But this also makes that the structure is actually very fragile. There were ribbons on top of the purse, which are also partially missing. And they were made by a braid of textile yarns and metal threads together. So we started first with dye analysis. That's my favorite, of course. But the thing is, we only could do very fragmentary sampling of it. So we could take finally a small sample of the reddish threads and of the greenish threads of the central decoration, and then a green thread from the braids on top of the image. So what was the result? In fact, the green threads were dyed with indigo or woad, Again, in combination with the yellow, luteolene yellow dye source. And for the reds, we found that it was dyed with saffron wood. Caesalpinia's saffron was used. And in fact, the same dye source was found in a small sample from the lining, which we achieved to sample. So we know that also the inner side was a reddish lining. But as you can see, the results are quite fragmentary. We were allowed to take two sample ends from metal threads, one from the central decoration and one from the ribbon. The first one, you can see the image of the sample at the bottom. We did SEM EDX, and this resulted in the identification of the composition in the way that we know it's a gilded silver thread, a strip which is round and has twisted around a core of undyed silk. The second sample was taken at the end of the ribbon, and there we found it is a silver strip, so not gilded. Also in a twist around silk core. So, but these were the only two samples we could take and we were allowed to take. But at the end, there's a complete metal thread decoration, so we were not sure if the same metal thread was used all the time. So this was the good occasion to go a bit further. And so we started to analyze the whole purse, in fact, with the micro XRF scanning device. And these are the details about what we did. So we measured an area, so the whole purse, about 190 to 124 millimeter of the front and the reverse side of the purse. I'm not going into detail, but if you have questions, I can answer later on. According to these settings, the complete analysis time of it was about 6 hours. So what do we get out of it? You get distribution maps of different elements that are present. So in this case, we focused on gold, silver, and the copper that were detected. And so you can see them here. What makes it here a bit complicated is the fact that with that technique you measure the elements not only on the surface but also in the underlying layers, so in this case also on the reverse side. This we could have avoided by putting a lead-in plate, but it was not allowed because the lining is completely gone and it was too fragile to do that. So this makes the images a bit more complicated than it should be. But nevertheless, we can see clearly that, when you go and look into detail, that the nettles are present at the same areas, all three of them. And you also can use with the software, you can use a superposition of the different mappings so that you can see if there are areas where one of the two nettles are not present and so on. So in this case, it was clear that the same metal, the gilded silver metal thread was used for the whole decoration, which also contains some copper, which is not present on that slide, but on the earlier one. So, and you get a picture about the pattern which is made by these metal threads. Because visually, a lot of them, a lot of parts of the metal threads are not clear anymore because they have become very dark. But there's more to see, not only the metal threads are detected. For instance, the distribution map of iron gave us also a very good response. So everywhere where you see the white, there is iron present. And in fact, this is completely coinciding with the use of black yarns in the purse. And we know that black yarns can be made by black dyeing of the fibers with tannin together with an iron mordant, an iron salt. So in this case, probably vitriol was used. So in fact, we cut immediately a pattern of the use of the black yarns. And we also can see where they are missing, because a lot of parts where the black yarns were there have become gaps now. So to conclude for this purse, in fact, also a sample has to be taken for radiocarbon dating, and there it came out that it was with 80% probability between 1150 and 1250 AD. So it is earlier than previously was expected from the art historical point of view. And furthermore, the dye analysis showed, due to the detection, the use of sapan wood, that at least all either the dye or the silk yarn or the fabric itself could be an import from the East. In that period, sapan wood only coming from the East was possible. And then, so the composition from the two samples we analyzed gave us the identification of gilded silver used in the central decoration and the silver threads used in the ribbon. And furthermore, the scanning technique allowed us to see the distributions of these metal threads decorations and to visualize the pattern more in detail of the metal threads. And we also could see, due to the iron, the distribution of the black yarns. So, this is to give a bit an idea. I'm just going to give a quick look on two other purses where we found other things. So the second one is a purse in needlework, which was also dated art historically to the 14th century. It's very deteriorated. And here we did a macroxide scanning on the rectangle you can see, so the blue rectangle. And so we took a part of the purse and a part of these knots and the fringes. So it's clear that, again, out of the distribution knots of gold and silver, we can see that the metal threads that were used in these knots are gilded silver. So visually, it's not so clear anymore. It might look very obvious, but visually, you cannot be sure that it's gilded silver. And there are a lot of areas where the metals are gone, but even then, by the scanning technique, it becomes clear what the where they were present before. We also see that there is some copper, and this coincides with the small parchment band, and also some iron. So we did a second analysis just of the parchment banner, which we stretched to be able to do the mapping. And there it becomes clear that the iron and the copper are from the handwriting on the parchment. So it's made by iron gall ink. And the further step, this is going to be analyzed as well to have more information about the handwriting in function of the dating. And then there was a third purse, which is a silk embroidery. Also, it's in a better state. It has metal thread decorations in the geometric pattern. Here again, the distribution maps. We see several things. The first are repetitions. In fact, again, the gold and the silver distribution on the left, they show us where the metal threads, the gilded silver, is present. And then the iron distribution again showed us where the black yarns were. But then we also see some other things which are not visible at the other side of the process. And this is mentioned here in red. So there are some metal threads, gilded silver, and also parts that contain a lot of copper at the bottom, which are at the inner side of the purse and which are part of the construction of the purse. So it might be also useful for objects where you cannot look inside or in the different layers. With this scanning technique, you can see things and then you have more to search for later on. So, but this can reveal some hidden items too. So this is in fact what I wanted to show. It's just a technique that might give new opportunities, not only for dispersers, but also for other types of archaeological materials and even textiles, but for textiles and others. So it's non-invasive. You can use it. I think it's useful most as a screening technique before you start any manipulation. And it helps to visualize elements that are present at the outer side, but also to see some hidden elements. And so it's helpful to minimize then the sampling if you want to do other analysis. And last but not least, it's also applicable on larger objects. So it's only a small particular point on the whole project, but I thought it was a nice occasion to present it here. Thank you very much.